this class we will discuss the loads that are to be considered for design of berthing structures. We have to consider the dead load, live load, berthing force, mooring force, seismic force, active air pressure, differential water pressure. So these are the various loads that are to be considered. The optimum design will take place only if you find out the forces properly. The failure also takes place if you don't estimate the forces accurately. Out of these loads, for certain type of structures, some loads will be governing the design. For example, for the berthing structure in seismic zone 5 near Kandla and Andaman group of islands, seismic force will control the design. Whereas at other locations, berthing force may control the design. Out of all the forces that have been listed here, there are certain forces which are permanently present. These forces are dead load, active air pressure, and differential water pressure, always present. So we have to give due importance to this. Whereas the seismic force will take place only there is an earthquake. The berthing force will take place when there is a berthing of vessel. The mooring force will take place when the vessel moves away from the berth, and when the vessel is subjected to wind and current, which makes the vessel to displace from its position. Since it is connected to the bollards, there will be mooring forces. The live load, there are various categories of live load. One of them is uniformly distributed live load, another is the crane load, the third one is the conveyor load. If you are having railway line and road, we have to consider this. If we have pipeline, we have to consider this. These cranes, we have two types of cranes. One is a mobile harbor crane, another is rail key crane. So these are the loads, live loads. So what is the difference between the structure what you will be building in the land, for example this structure and the berthing structure, is the live load what is normally used in buildings is only 5 kilonewton per meter square, whereas for berthing structures it can go up to 50 kilonewton per meter square. This is a heavy load, 50. So for this place where we are sitting and listening to the lecture, the live load is 5 kilonewton per meter square. 5 kilonewton is how many kg?
500 kg.
In 1 meter by 1 meter, how many people can stand? You have come through the lift, right? When you have come through the lift, they would have written what is the load the lift can carry. Size of the lift is more. In a 1 meter by 1 meter space, how many people can stand? 9, depending on the bulkiness of the person. So if you take it as 9, average weight is What is the average weight of Indians? 60 kg. Okay. 9 into 60 is 540 kg. Just to give an example only, I told the 50 kN/m² is coming because if you stack for 5 meter height coal bulk density is very close to 10 kN/m². You are 10 kN/m³. If you stack it for 5 meters, 5 into 10, it will become 50 kN/m². Suppose you are using finished steel products, density of steel is very high, then the load will be large. The problem is not with the large intensity, there is a design issue, but the major problem is with seismic force. Seismic force is a horizontal force. This horizontal force can be calculated by using a formula where AH comes into picture. So, this is the formula that is used to get the horizontal force. When you talk about the loads, we also have to see how the loads are acting. The loads can be vertical or lateral. Vertical means the self weight of the structure is going down, that is vertical. When the wind is blowing on a multi-storied building, there is a load which is going in the lateral direction. For a design of structure, lateral loads are very important, very difficult. Generally, lateral load capacity of any structure will be about 10% of the capacity in the vertical direction. Okay. For example, you can take some weight on top of your head. Weightlifters or somebody can take up to 30 kg, 40 kg and all. But if someone wants to pull you or push you, what is the force required? Very negligible. Maybe 2 kg is sufficient to pull you. Same case with the structure also, the lateral load capacity will be very less. The seismic force is a lateral load. AH is the horizontal coefficient. You want to calculate the seismic force in the horizontal direction, that will be AH multiplied by dead load plus 50% of live load. So when you assume 50 kN/m², the 50% of the live load into AH comes into picture. We will study this parameter separately in one of the classes. So the loads, when you classify, you can also classify whether loads are coming from the sea side or from the land side. Okay. This active earth pressure, differential water pressure and all coming from the land side, whereas the berthing force and mooring force are coming from the sea side. That is, from the ship the loads are transferred, whereas from the soil which is backfilled and variation in water level, you get this pressure. The seismic force, which direction it will act? What is the direction of the seismic force? I told it is lateral. It will act from the sea side to land side or land side to sea side? You tell wrong answer, no problem. Which direction the seismic force acts? What is it?
Land side to
sea side. It can act any side. It can act in the vertical direction, lateral direction, left to right, right to left, diagonal. It depends on the direction in which the seismic acceleration travels. So for example, if you take a structure like this, what is shown in this slide, it can act from this side to this side, this side to this side, it can go like this also, any direction it can act. It can go up and down also. The seismic acceleration, AH is high. If you want to take A vertical, it is some percentage of AH. Maybe, I do not remember it, maybe 50% or 2/3 of AH, that is the coefficient. This mobile harbor crane generally consists of 4 pads. I will show the photograph in another class, but typically this dimension is about 12 meter by 12 meter and this dimension is about 5.5 meter by 1.8 meters and the intensity of the load on the pad is about 2000 kilonewton per meter square. Sometime it is more also, we can 2000 to 2900. So, you know what is the load UDL, this is 50 kilonewton per meter square, this is throughout the structure, whereas when the mobile harbor crane is moving for lifting the cargo from the vessel, there will be 4 pads and each pad will have a load of about 2000 kilonewton per meter square to 2900 kilonewton per meter square. It is only a patch load, it is not a continuous load. But rail key crane, there will be wheels, typically there will be 16 wheels and each wheel load will be about 500 kilonewtons. Can have about 24 wheels also. So, this is the order of the load. I think this is wrong, I think it is about 200 to 2900, it is 200 to 290 or 2000. So, this class we will see active earth pressure and differential water pressure. I have written in this active passive, we will discuss that. What is earth pressure? The earth pressure is exerted by the backfill on the wall. The nature and extent of the wall movement alters the lateral earth pressure of the backfill exerted on it. So, for example, you are having a diaphragm wall and there is a fill behind the diaphragm wall. Suppose the wall is removed, the soil will collapse, that means the wall is retaining the soil and there is a pressure exerted by the wall. Otherwise, for example, if there is a water tank filled with water, what happens? The water will exert pressure on the wall, same way earth also exert pressure on the wall. There are 3 earth pressure, one is earth pressure at rest, another is active earth pressure, the third one is passive earth pressure. So, if the wall moves, so whenever there is a pressure exerted on the wall is trying to move. When the wall moves sufficiently away from the backfill, either by translatory motion or by rotation about the base or the combination, lateral earth pressure of the backfill is reduced. Reduced means it is reduced from earth pressure at rest to active earth pressure. Suppose the wall moves sufficiently towards the backfill by translatory motion or rotation about the base, it should be R, or their combination, the backfill offers resistance. What is earth pressure at rest? There is no wall movement, the pressure exerted by the backfill is termed as the earth pressure at rest. These are the 3 definitions. I will explain with a figure. Suppose you are installing a diaphragm wall and there is soil on both the sides. Afterwards, you are going to dredge. This case is earth pressure at rest. You will have pressure from this side as well as from the other side. So, this is k naught gamma h. Gamma is the density of the soil, h is the height. Suppose this is the h height. Gamma into h at every point, here there is no overburden pressure. Overburden pressure means the weight of the soil above. Here there is overburden pressure that is equal to this height into the density. If you here you have overburden pressure that is equal to k naught into h. As you go down, the overburden pressure increases. And this is called as a coefficient k naught. It can be less than 1 or greater than 1. Suppose it is 1, whatever is the vertical pressure, same thing is applied on the horizontal direction. Suppose you remove the soil on this side, so much portion of the soil you remove. So, we remove about H1 quantity of soil. What will happen to the wall? One of the main thing you have to understand is whenever there is a force in the structure, there is always a displacement, both are together. So, when there is a pressure, the wall is trying to displace, the wall will try to move and you will have the displacement of the wall may move something like this. So, whenever you do the stat pro analysis or any analysis, you have to look for two things, one is the force, another is the displacement. Force is three translational force and movements, three movements. Displacement, generalized displacement is three displacements, translationary and three rotations. So, what will happen to the earth pressure now, k naught gamma h, will it increase or decrease? Will it increase or it will decrease? No idea. This is the soil. In relation to the soil, this is the point where the deflection is 0. Above this point, whether the wall is moving away from the soil or moving towards the soil, moving
away from the soil.
Away from the soil. What happens below this? Wall is moving towards the soil. So you know this boxing. When somebody wants to hit you, what you are trying to do? You are trying to dodge away. Somebody wants to hit. Will you stand like this straight? You will go. And if somebody is trying to hit you and if you go away, the impact will be less. But if you stand like this stubbornly, then the impact is more. So, by the same hypothesis, when the wall is moving away, the active earth pressure will take place and it will reduce from k naught to k a. And passive earth pressure will take place on the other side, because there is a soil here. This diagram is not correct exactly, actually it will go like this and it may come down like this also. We will have k p gamma h, this is only schematic, it depends on which place you are having. So, now we will read this sentence very carefully. There is this is not a literature, it is a technical documentation. So, we have every word has a meaning. If there is no wall movement, the pressure exerted by the backfill is termed the earth pressure at rest. That is the first case. Second case, if the wall moves sufficiently away, I will explain in the next slide what is the sufficiently away. There is a reason for putting sufficiently away from the backfill, by translatory motion or rotation about the base or their combination, lateral pressure of the backfill is reduced from k naught to k a. If the wall moves sufficiently towards the backfill by translatory motion or rotation about the base or their combination, the backfill offers resistance. We have used the word resistance because the mobilization of passive earth pressure is equal to the load that is applied to the wall. It will have the capacity, passive earth pressure capacity, but it will not be the mobilized. Whatever active earth pressure is coming, based on that only the mobilization will take place. For example, the capacity of the structure, passive earth pressure is like this, but the mobilization will go something like this. The concept is whatever force you are getting this side will be equal to the force on this side, force equilibrium. You cannot equate the pressure, please remember, you can never equate pressure, you have to equate only the force, you have to calculate the force and equate. So you have sigma of all the forces to be equal to 0, sigma of all the movement to be equal to 0, that condition is to be realized. So the active earth pressure is the pressure that is acting on the structure. You can calculate the force due to active earth pressure, same amount only will be mobilized on the other side, same force, though it has the capacity. The soil at the top will get fully mobilized, as you go down it won't get mobilized. There is another statement that is made, that is, what is the earth pressure coefficient? So let us say the deflection of the wall or rotation of the wall or displacement on the x axis and the pressure coefficient on the y axis. So we will have the curve going something like this. This is called as k naught. This remains constant after some time, it does not increase further. This is called as k p. This remains constant here, this is called as k a. I will be asking this question in the exam. It is not there in the PowerPoint. So those who have not come to the class, you tell them to read this figure. It may not be available in many textbooks also, soil mechanics textbooks, but this is a very important curve. So typically for a sandy soil, phi is equal to 30 degrees, k naught equal to 1, k a is equal to 1 by 3, k p is equal to. So from k naught it reduces to k a after sufficient movement. If the movement is not sufficient, you won't get k a, it will be more than k a. Similarly, full passive pressure will mobilize only if it moves from here. For example, if you are getting somewhere here, the pressure coefficient is between 1 and 3. If the movement is here, the pressure coefficient is between 1 and 1 by 3. So the force which is exerted depends on the wall movement. That means the stiffness of the structure comes into picture. The movement of the structure depends on the stiffness of the structure. Stiffness means Young's modulus, moment of inertia. So the earth pressure at rest, we have a code called IS 4651 part 2. You can calculate using P naught pressure is equal to K naught and gamma Z. What is the unit of gamma? What is the unit of P naught then?
Kilonewton per meter square.
Meter square. So we are multiplying by Z, that is the depth. So kilonewton per meter cube into meter is kilonewton per meter square. K naught is a earth pressure coefficient, no units. This k naught varies depending on the type of soil. There is a table that is not shown here. When I discuss this code, I will show that to you. How to calculate the active earth pressure? This is the formula. Active earth pressure is k a gamma h minus 2 c root of k a plus k a into q, where k a is equal to 1 minus sin phi divided by 1 plus sin phi gamma is the unit weight of soil, h is the depth of soil above the section, it is shown here, q is the surcharge in kilonewton per meter square, phi is the angle of internal friction, and k is the coefficient of active air pressure, and c is the cohesion. There are two properties that are required for a soil. One is called as angle of internal friction, another is called as cohesion. Cohesion is for clay soil. For sandy soil there is no cohesion, c will be equal to 0. But you have sandy clay where you will have both phi as well as c, then you have to use this equation. So if you do not have, if you have c is equal to 0, then we will have Ka gamma h only. But if you have surcharge, then you will have Ka gamma h plus Ka q. For cohesive soils, phi will be 0. When phi is 0, what is the value of Ka? 1 minus sin phi by 1 plus sin phi. What is the value? 1. So you will have gamma h minus 2c plus Kaq. That is the formula. That is how to, whenever you read a formula, you substitute some limit values. You can substitute phi is equal to 0, you can substitute c is equal to 0, you can substitute q is equal to 0. Do not substitute gamma is equal to 0. Gamma is equal to 0 means nothing is there. These are the independent variables. H can be made as 0, H 0 means there is no soil above, C can be made as 0, and Q can be made as 0. What is this Q? Suppose there is some load on this. This load is typically about 25 kilonewton per meter cube. That is whatever live load you are assuming. Generally the surcharge load is taken as 50%, but 50 also can happen. So I told you overburden pressure. Overburden pressure is gamma into H. When there is no surcharge, the overburden pressure here is 0. But when there is a surcharge, what is the overburden pressure? 50 kilonewton per meter. So what happens is you have the air pressure due to surcharge which goes like this. So this value is Ka into Q. The unit for Q is kilonewton per meter square, and the surcharge pressure is equal to Ka into Q. Any doubts in this? But this is a simple calculation, undergraduate level. How many civil engineering students are there? BTech. All of you have studied this. What did you learn new today? Already studied, no? What is that you have learned today compared to what you know already? Nothing. You please tell, you already studied air pressure. Do you know what is the effect of movement of the wall on air pressure coefficient? That curve is known to you? Yes or no? Yes. Who has taught you? Who has taught this in civil engineering? Rajagopal, he has shown this curve. He has done this curve. But that lady was telling, she knows. That person also was telling.
Our sir is different. Our sir is different.
Who is your sir? You don't know his name.
Dalinaidu Arnapalli.
What is it?
Dalinaidu Arnapalli.
Oh. What about you?
Same, sir.
He has done this curve. We will continue with the differential water pressure in the next class.